3 years ago, I was asked to start building a museum of history, a national museum that would show the entire Dutch culture and history. We actually came to a point where you could say that the traditional museum as it was invented in the 19th century is no longer something you would want to build in the 21st century. And over the last 3 years, we've developed all kind of techniques to tell a story, the story of Holland, but also the many stories of the Dutch people, not using a building and paintings on the wall or artifacts in a cabinet, but still just using their stories in the communication channels that they have on a daily basis in front of them, that they use anyway. So we use a lot of new media, we use a lot of new technology, but the bottom line is that we go where the people are with the stories that they tell, and that in itself is a new way of looking at a museum. The problem with the word museum is that when you say museum, people think of a building and paintings and artifacts, and those images are important as illustration to a story, of course. But often what happens in the museum is that the story gets told in such a way that people can't relate. It's not their story, it's the story of the curator, it's the story of the director, it's the story of a country that wants their people to think that their history consists solely of highlights. And what you need to do in a time where everybody has access to all kinds of media is to turn it around and tell the story in the language that people understand, but also to tell their story and make it something they own. So the museum is no longer a factory of stuff you offer and people take it or leave it. The museum becomes owned by the people themselves, and therefore because they feel that ownership, it's no longer something they dread going to, but it becomes part of their daily routine. That's why you shouldn't do it in a building that's called a museum. You should brand it as something they can find on every street corner. One of the main things we've done is we identified hundreds of locations that have an historical significance. We put markers down there and people can scan those markers with their smartphone and get on their smartphone all the information about that location from us as the provider, but also from other museums that have a special interest in that location or special knowledge, but also Wikipedia knowledge or cartoons or old fragments from news bulletins or documentaries. And in such a way, the whole country becomes a museum. Problem is, the word is wrong. The word still reminds us of that old building. What we need to do is invent a brand that people recognize as the provider of all this information. And the brand has to be such that people also see it as their particular brand. So it's not we, the provider, we provide quality historic information. No, the brand is owned by every single person in the country. People have very different ideas of what's historic to them. Young people, 7, 8, 9 year olds, usually find something historic that for us is contemporary, because we go back much further, we can think back much further. And just that discourse about what is historic, and does it need to be a real artifact, or can it just be something that is for me? If somebody can put in an old photograph of their grandfather because they have great memories of that person and say, this is my historic object that I want to tell everybody about. And somebody else will say, no, it has to be, you know, an old stone that was used to cut or to a prehistoric artifact. An old scent, since we no longer use them, is historic for many people that still experience the pre-Euro era. But for young people, usually that doesn't make much sense because they can't relate. And it's about the debate. It's not about the artifact itself. It's hardly about the form we chose for this exhibition. It's mainly about the debate that follows on the choices that have been made, and that conversation in itself enriches a society or a community. It's all to do with ownership. If you really want to convince somebody to believe something, to incorporate an educational fact, to relate to something or to buy something, you have to create at least the illusion, but hopefully more than that, of ownership. You have to make people give people a sense that it's not just that I convince you to do something or to believe something or to take in some knowledge or to buy something. You actually will be better off doing that. And after doing that, you are probably the best ambassador of that particular product or that particular piece of knowledge. If I tell you the facts of Dutch history, and I do that in the typical traditional way of a summing up of events and years and people, and you probably doze off after 5 minutes, and you won't remember much. And there is no way that you A, will do something with that knowledge, but more importantly B, you will never tell anybody else about it because you can't recall or retell that knowledge. Therefore, you need to go back to less information, personalize that information in a very touching story, a very famous example of that we came across is we have to tell children about the war, and the last year of the war was a very difficult time in Holland because there was a lot of hunger, and people think that, you know, everybody was looking out for tulip bulbs to eat, and that you know, there was, of course, life went on as normal, but with hunger. I mean, society continues to function. How do you tell children that those two things can exist at the same time? And we found that at some point a poetry album that small girls use to have their friends write little poems to each other, and they put little pictures with it of little kittens or flowers or doggies, and they, you know, make it into a nice page, and every girl friend of the girl in question has their own page in this little booklet. And during that period of the last part of the war, the girls did the same thing, but they used food stamps instead of the pictures weren't available, it was whatever happened. They used food stamps as decoration in those little albums. And every girl in the Netherlands can relate to that because they understand what this album is, because they still use it. They can also understand that if you do not have access to the typical elements that you use, you start using other things. And it is a perfect moment to explain about why you have food stamps. What is a food stamp? Nobody understands that. So you can, you know, you need that to actually get a little bit of food that is available to distribute that evenly over the mouth. It's a very small example of how you can have a deep impact on a small group in a classroom of children. And these children will go home and they will say, what we've seen now is so, you know, that captured me. Your story needs to grab you somewhere, you know, between your throat and your waist. You know, it needs to grab your heart. And when it does that, you're sold. Now, that's in business should be the same. I mean, if you're, I do a lot of work for banks. If you look at the banking industry, I mean, financially they're still afloat, luckily, but morally, you know, in the eyes of many people, they are bankrupt. They need to regain the trust of their community. That can only be done if you create some ownership. Start thinking about how you can present that product in such a way that people feel ownership of their bank. Not by owning it literally, but by believing that banking there makes them proud. Where do you invest your money? Which ethical policies do you implement? How do you communicate that? Do you give people a say in those kind of policies? People know a lot about their customers, but maybe it's more important to know what moves society. What is it that people long for? Is it to buy the peanut butter or the washing powder? I doubt it. It's probably the people have a strong sense that their community is disintegrating. They want to come back to something smaller they can relate to. People have great concerns about the environment. People have worries about the financial security of their children. There's a lot of social issues that you can that you can define as part of what society is. Now, how does your product relate to those issues, and how can you then make people the ambassador for your product? So if you should sell a washing powder, don't sell it because it washes white, sell it because, and make sure it's good for the environment. Make sure that it does everything it needs to do, but go one step further and really say, okay, you know, nobody cares about washing your clothes because everybody knows we need to do it. So let's forget about all that. This does all the things it needs to do, but we need to go further. We need to go, and in this particular instance, think about what is the effect on our environment. Make sure that it works and make people believe that it works. Convince them and make them their own, your ambassador in that story. And then you can enter the social media like everybody else does. But only if your story is convincing enough. Don't stick with the idea that short-term effects like sales is going to salvage your image in the long run, because it is not. People are way too smart to fall for that every time again. In the end, it will have to do with the greater picture of what a community needs. And it sounds very stretched. You know, it sounds very much like, how can you possibly tell something sensible about a washing powder? The point is, if you can't do it on washing powder, if you can't do it on consumer goods, why would you do it on banking? Why would you do it on anything else? It's you have to turn it around. You have to start saying, okay, every product needs to have a purpose, and if it doesn't have a purpose, maybe we shouldn't make it. Maybe we should make something that has a better, that plays a better role in gluing the community, or in making people healthier or smarter or more productive, or just happy is good enough. But try and make people part of your product rather than buy just your product.